where neither the sexual body nor the authority of the saint was concerned. Sanctity over a gender in the portrayal of the early Irish saints, and joking relationships could be used in the same manner to assert the position or personality of the saint. Humour occurred in a range of forms and served a wide variety of functions in early medieval hagiography. Although this humour has long been recognised as being present, it is only relatively recently that an attempt has been made to categorise it and determine its purpose. Modern humour theories have been invaluable in both of these tasks, and have demonstrated that rather than being an oddity, the presence of humour in religious texts serves specific and invaluable functions. In the Irish lives, saints were portrayed in a seemingly discordant fashion, being at once both distant and other as agents of God, and living on a celestial level, while simultaneously maintaining intimate and personal terrestrial ties with their adherents. Through the use of joking relationships, these Irish lives were able to consolidate the saint's position as outside and above the normal person, while simultaneously reaffirming the saint's ties to the saint community. Although humour was prevalent in both the male and female Irish saints' lives, there were differences in the way in which it was utilised. Whether humour was completely external to the saint and did not relate to the body, there was generally no apparent gendering in the portrayal. The same events were depicted in the same manner in male and female lives. This was not the case, however, where hagiographers had to portray the body. Social inversion, the contrast of a strong, domineering woman with a submissive male figure, specifically a vulnerable, naked one, was used only in the female Irish lives. Male Irish saints were contrasted either with vulnerable, naked male or female bodies. Male authority over females was the default option. It did not need to be repeatedly defended. Female authority over males, however, was justified by their professional role, and with this, their separation from the rest of their gender. As with many aspects of Irish hagiography, where there was precedence for these power plays in pre-Christian society, sanctity could override gender in order for it to maintain a homogenous approach to portraying early Irish sanctity, authority, and wisdom. It was only where the physical reminder of the biological differences between males and females were brought to the fore that Irish hagiographers struggled with the idealized third gender. Gender overrode sanctity, where gender could not be ignored. This authority and positioning of the third gender was fragile, however, and could not be undermined or threatened by placing the female saint in a position of weakness or potential mockery. Thus, in one-on-one joking relationships, the female saint was mocked, but always shown to be correct. And while she might be too saintly to function properly in a normal world, she was always credited with a sympathetic, forgiving nature when dealing with repentant sinners. Female Irish saints differ from their male counterparts in being more accessible to the people of their parochia. Finally, the body of the female Irish saint was more sacred and untouchable than that of the male saint, because it was potentially more human and sexually charged. Male saints could perform grotesque actions, or even be grotesque themselves. While the grotesque and macabre were an important component in early Irish humour, this was not overlaid onto the female saint's body. In early Irish saga literature, physical perfection was a component of honour. And while male saints could be portrayed as challenging this norm, the female saint's body was returned to perfection after any fall, and their bodies were not made objects of ridicule or mockery. Theoretically, female saints may have formed a part of the third gender, but this was difficult to portray consistently, and so their hagiographers veered clear of diminishing the respect in which they were held, and the perfection of their body and sanctity. Both modern and medieval understandings of sanctity have attempted to delineate clear demarcations between male and female saints. But it has also become apparent that there were other factors that frequently blurred the boundaries defined by gender. The very nature of sanctity made it an act of transgression, and hagiographers struggled to deal with this issue, creating new paradigms and ideals to encompass a new belief system and a form of power. Theoretically, the existence of a saintly third gender allowed men to access feminine characteristics and women access to masculine ones, without threatening the dominant ideology that cemented the basic structure of everyday life. But while conceptually saints might be seen as a group apart, independent from the lay men and women with whom they interacted, in practice, those who wrote about them were men and women themselves, constrained in their own gendered mindset into preformed, constructed notions of how men and women could and should be portrayed. And this informed their writing, and in particular, their use of Irish saintly humour.
Celia, that was most illuminating. Now, we do have time for questions or comments.
I just have a little comment, really. I was struck that from the outset, the two examples you chose, the first two, involve crossing water. Mm-hmm. And I'm wondering if there's any. Can you give us a reflection on whether they are peculiar because of that, or are there more examples in that sort of age-old trope of water crossing being dangerous or being marginal or borderlands? Or is that just two peculiar ones and the rest aren't?
Those are the only two I've come across that specifically relate to water. I haven't looked at it from that aspect, but it's an interesting one. I'll see if I can find any other ones. Because it brings in that whole liminal aspect and the crossing of changing states.
The examples you gave us, were they seen at the time as basically moral or religious tales, or were they perceived as jokes? What was the perception intended to be given by the story?
That's where you get the tricky area. We don't know what the audience response was. All the examples did come from hagiography, so from saints' lives. So they obviously served a religious function of some sort. I think, and based on other studies of humour that's been found in other areas, that they did serve a humour function, that they were seen as funny by some aspects of the audience. But I do also think one of the deals with humour is that you never get an entire group that agrees that something's funny. And for some people it would be hilarious, and other people would be a little bit offensive, and other people just won't understand what you're talking about, while some people just see the first level and say, it's a story. They do have a moral message to them, but I think the use of humour within it just makes them more memorable. And it has been shown that humour has been used across a range of cultures to try and make something more memorable, to make it stick in your mind so that you do remember what the moral message is that goes with it.
Yes, we have a question.
Thank you. Tim, did I hear you say that this is the third gender which saints? Is it saints equals third gender?
Not always. Third gender's been used in a vast array of different means by different people. I specifically use it, and it has been used by others, to refer to an aspirational group that saints put in, so that you don't have to see them as human. They're moved beyond. And it gives them a separate access to power, a way of stepping beyond boundaries so that they're not actually physically attacking or behaviourally attacking cultural norms.
Is that in the medieval text or is that a modern category? Contemporary category?
The earliest reference to it I found is in the 3rd century, where it's referring to eunuchs. The third gender then.
That's not necessarily saints.
No, not saints then. I haven't seen it used for saints at the time, though there is a vague reference in Gregory of Tours where he implies something, but I could be reading something into what he's said there. Other people have read it in as well, but it may well be because of our training and our thinking that we do that. And it's been taken up very much in the last 15, 20 years by different groups to try and explain different aspects.
Perhaps we would thank you, and perhaps as we have to wait for the parallel session, if there are any questions for Liam, if there aren't any further questions, then happy hour for you. But let's thank you for us. Are there any